suena y la orquesta.
So this past Friday at our Hey Day event, there were many just amazing experiences that you got to see in the video. You'll see more pictures throughout the week of just the fun things that our kids and I think our adults had some fun as well serving. And some of those experiences for our kids, even like our little preschoolers, were first-time experiences. And for some of them, they were a little bit scared. The first time that they were face to face with an alpaca, or you know, the first time that they were going on a hayride, and it was like, wait a second, when I'm on a vehicle, I have 15 harnesses and straps, and this is the first time where I'm just sitting next to friends, or what, you know, the bouncy house. Some of you even saw on the way in today, the bouncy house is up after the service. Definitely feel free to jump on it as well. That's for adults and kids, okay? But just, you know, you see the little trepidation of a five-year-old getting into the bouncy house and trying to kind of get their feet underneath them, not sure what's going to happen. There's a little fear behind these first-time experiences. But when there's the support of their friends, when there's the support of some adults, they're able to enjoy those experiences and move past their fears. Now, we would like to convince ourselves sometimes that being scared or being afraid is something that we only deal with as little kids, or maybe something that we deal with the first time, but I think deep down you and I all know that there are real fears and there are things that we really are afraid of or scared of in our lives today. And maybe it's not experiences, and maybe it can go down the list of like phobias, you can go online and there's just a list, hundreds upon hundreds of phobias, some very rational and some very irrational phobias. But to even take it one step further, I think there are real fears that you and I have every single day. Fears of being alone, of not being able to provide for a family. Fears of hearing the C word at the doctor's office. Being afraid of then what that season of life will look like. Being afraid of any type of sickness that may come, being afraid of losing a parent or a spouse, being afraid of walking into your boss's office and walking out with no job. The list can go on and on of real fears that you and I can be afraid of. And so what happens and what are we to do when we have to face these fears? Well, I think the answer we can find today not only comes from God's word, but it's looking to God himself. And so this morning, as we continue on in this series, Summer Playlist, we've been talking about different songs that we put on when we're feeling something in our hearts. And I believe there's a song, or maybe specifically a psalm, that we can put on repeat, that we can read over and over and over again that will help calm the fears that we have to face today. And so if you have a Bible, go ahead and turn to Psalm chapter 23. Psalm chapter 23, it's probably one of the most well-known psalms in our Bibles. If you have a Bible in the seat back in front of you, it's on page 441. If you're grabbing your phone, pull up your Bible app. The Bible verses are also going to be up on the screen throughout our time together this morning. And so as you're turning to Psalm 23, I just want to give you a little background as to what's happening. King David is the author of this psalm. As we've talked about, he wrote about half of the books of the Psalms in our Bible, and it's a place in his life where he has every reason to be afraid. He has every reason to be filled with fear. It's during this time in David's life that he is on the run from Saul. See, King David at this point is not king. He's just a shepherd boy at this point, but God has anointed him. God has chosen him to be the next king over Israel because the king in charge right now, King Saul, was not doing a good job. His heart had strayed away from God, and he was leading Israel down a path God did not want his people to go down. And so God had told Saul, you're going to be king no more. When you pass, the kingdom will be ripped away from your family line, and it will be given to David. Well, Saul didn't like that, and he tried to take matters into his own hands. And so this psalm, as well as many other psalms that David wrote, are when he is on the run for his life. He was very close with Saul, and he was best friends with Saul's son, Jonathan, but no longer is he able to be in the king's presence. And so he is running all over Israel, the mountainside, countryside. Bible scholars estimate that anywhere between 3 to 7 years that David was on the run for his life, that King Saul was using Israel's army and their forces to come and find David and kill him. So David has every right to be afraid, but what we see here in this psalm this morning, and it's our big idea for the morning, is what David does to help him when he has every reason to be afraid, when he has every reason to be scared. And this is our big idea. It's this, is that I can trust God when I'm afraid because he provides, he comforts, and he redeems. I can trust God to be when I'm afraid because he provides, he comforts, and he redeems. And so in these short 6 verses that we will look over this morning, we're going to see how God provides, how God comforts, and how God redeems, and how because of his faithfulness, because of him doing that over and over and over again, we can trust him when we're feeling afraid, when we are experiencing fear in our lives. And so we're going to look at this first one, these first couple verses, how God provides. How God provides. So Psalm chapter 23, starting in verse 1. And before I read that, I just want to say this. It's just a reminder that here at Avenue, we teach from God's word every week because we believe God has primarily spoken to us through his word. And not only do we believe the Bible, God's word, is true, but that it's very applicable to our lives today. And so we're going to see how this psalm applies to our fear-filled situations today. So Psalm chapter 23, starting in verse 1, it says this. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. We'll stop there. See, throughout Scripture, God describes himself as a shepherd to his people. In the book of John chapter 10, Jesus, he describes himself as the good shepherd. And we also know that David, before becoming king, was a shepherd. A shepherd was a very common job within the Israelite culture. They would take care of the sheep. And so this analogy may not make sense to us today, since no one's going to their 9-to-5 tomorrow to be a shepherd. But the shepherd was an important part of Israelite culture. And this idea here that the Lord is my shepherd, it would ring powerfully into the people, especially to David. Why is that? Well, because they knew that sheep were some of the most scared animals. Like the animal that you think would just get the most scared about anything, it's a sheep. They needed direction, they needed guidance, they needed protection. They could not exist apart from the shepherd. They have limited knowledge, limited capacity. They would not be able to do anything at all apart from their shepherd. Sheep were in desperate need, 24/7 need of their shepherd. And so what David is saying, by even saying, the Lord's my shepherd, I lack nothing, he is repeating himself, basically. And anytime there's repetition in Scripture, most of the time it's used for emphasis, to make sure that we understand this point. Because if you say, the Lord is my shepherd, well, yeah, I'm a sheep, I need him for everything. But David says, no, Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He provides everything for me. In the midst of running from caves and hiding outside and not having a home for quite some time, I know that God's providing for me. I know that God is taking care of me. And I think we can be reminded of that too, because sometimes we as sheep begin to take things into our own hands. And we have to be reminded that, no, God provides. God will take care of us. In verses 2 and 3, we see some practical ways that God provides for us and how the shepherd provides for his sheep. So verse 2, it says this, he makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. Now, sometimes when we read those couple of verses, we look at the end part of those lines. I'm in green pastures. This is great. I'm in quiet waters. My soul is refreshed. These are good things. But what we miss out on is those beginning words that I emphasize, that the shepherd makes us or that he leads us. You see, for a sheep, because they needed guidance and direction 24/7, if they didn't have a shepherd tell the sheep, hey, it's time to rest, time to sit down, time to relax, a sheep would just keep going and going and going and going. And sheep would be known just to, if they wander off, they would just keep walking and walking and wander off and be, you know, taken and eaten and killed by a wolf, or they would just keep going and they would just die of exhaustion. Sheep were not capable of understanding that they needed to take a break. And so the shepherd had to force the sheep to lie down, to rest. How true of that for us today? Living in the western suburbs of Chicago, sometimes we can just go, 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 go. And we just keep going, we keep grinding, we keep having to achieve, we keep having to do one thing after the other. And as we talked about a few weeks ago, and even in our Under the Surface series, is that God created us as humans who are limited in our physical capacity to rest, to reflect, to remember who God is, and more importantly, as we see here in the Ten Commandments, to Sabbath. To practice a time, a 24-hour time period, where we are resting from our work and enjoying his presence, contemplating who he is and how amazing he is, putting ourselves at a place of saying, I'm going to physically rest as a sign to myself that I am limited, yet God is limitless. And so if you miss any of those sermons in that series, or you're having questions about, okay, why do we physically rest? Why do we Sabbath? Why is this important for us? Why does the Good Shepherd make us lie down? There's some great resources that we've had along the way, and you can find that on our website, avenuechristian.com/resources. Even on the bottom of our main page, there's a button that says Under the Surface Resources. You can click on it, and it gives you just so many different things, apps that help you daily reflect and rest and remember who God is, as well as a 20-page ebook, very short read, about four different principles to apply to what does a Sabbath look like in, you know, 2022, as well as other resources throughout that series. That's all available on our website. But the reminder for us today, and we've seen this maybe in your own life or in the lives of others, is that burnout is real. It happens. People just, they work too hard, and we're not created to do that. And so the shepherd has to remind us, hey, this day, whatever your Sabbath day is, this 24-hour time period, whatever it is, rest, reflect, remember who I am, remember that the world will keep spinning even if you're not working because you're not in control. He is. But not only does the shepherd do this for the sheep, but at the end of verse 2, beginning of verse 3, he leads me beside quiet waters and he refreshes my soul. When you think about quiet waters or still waters, waters that have had that hot sun all summer and they're just sitting there and there's not fresh water getting into, there's not a river, there's nothing flowing out. What does that water look like? Have that picture in your mind. Now look up on the screen. It's murky, right? It's gross. It's disgusting. It's brown. There's bacteria and disease just like swimming around. But you know what, sheep? They're scared of everything, right? And so they would be scared of flowing fresh water. Even if it was a river at the banks and they just had to get their little nose or little mouth in there, they'd be too afraid to drink the fresh water. And so a sheep would say, hey, there's the quiet water, there's the still water, I'm going to go over there. And so the shepherd has to protect the sheep from the quiet, still, murky waters and bring them to the fresh water. But you may be thinking, wait a second, but it says that he leads me beside quiet waters. See, what shepherds then had to do, knowing the fear that the sheep have, they would have to go to the flowing fresh water. And they would have to, in many different ways, they would have to basically stop that water or create a space where they got the water, brought it out so that their sheep could drink then quiet, still waters. That was actually fresh and not murky and disgusting and gross. So the shepherd had to go above and beyond to take care of their sheep because the sheep was too afraid to do it. The shepherd provides for his sheep daily. And think about your life over these last couple years. It's been a crazy couple of years. There's been many times where we had real fears about real things that were really uncertain and unknown. Today, I would encourage you, or maybe even right now, God's even bringing some of those moments to your mind. How has God provided for you? What has God done to help you? How has he sustained you during this time, or maybe the season that you're facing right now? How is God providing for you daily? Because when we reflect back on what God has done, it reminds us that he's the one that got us through all this. And he's the one that will continue to get us through whatever it is that we're going through. And I love this last part. He refreshes my soul. As the water refreshes the sheep, we are reminded that God himself and his word refreshes our soul, spiritually feeds us. I don't think it's an accident that there are 365 verses in the Bible that say, do not fear. But there's a verse for every single day that God provides from his word to remind us that we don't need to fear and that he's given us his word as a spiritual provision to remind us that he's in control, that he's got it, he knows what he's doing, and that we can trust him. So we can trust God when we're afraid because he provides, but not only because he provides, but the second thing we'll see here is because he comforts, because God comforts us. So look with me here, the second part of verse 3 and verse 4. It says this, he guides me along the right path for his name's sake. And so even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. See, the shepherd will guide the sheep no matter where they need to go. The shepherd will be with them through all of it. And there were many times within the Israelite culture in the mountainous regions that they lived in that you had to go over high mountains or difficult terrain, or you had to go into low, difficult valleys. And a sheep on their own, they wouldn't want to do that. They wouldn't want to go down those valleys. They wouldn't want to try to go slowly down the hills, but the shepherd would lead them through those dark times, would lead them into those places where they would be really afraid and really scared. But the purpose was that the shepherd had to get the sheep to the other side, to the green pastures where they could lie down and rest and be refreshed. But along the way, as we see here in verse 4, that the rod and the staff of a shepherd would comfort the sheep. Well, why is that? Let's throw that picture of the staff and the rod. There's two different things that a shepherd would always carry with him. One is this rod, which is a small little club. You can see it up there. And the shepherd would have that to ward off any wild animals or any people that would try and take the sheep, kill the sheep, eat the sheep, whatever it is. And so this club was a club of protection. It was saying, hey, when my shepherd has this club in his hand, I know that I am safe. I know that I can trust that he's going to protect me. Now the staff, the one that has a little U at the top of it, this would be used to keep the sheep in line. So if the sheep didn't want to go down into the darkest valley, or didn't want to keep going, or sometimes because it wanted to keep going, needed to stop, the shepherd would gently use the staff to kind of bring the whole sheep back in, you know, just kind of get it around. Some of you parents are like, I need to get one of those in the grocery store. Like, that's a great idea. Just wrap it around and just shroop, come on back over here. Shepherds commonly use that. And so for the sheep to be reminded that, oh, the shepherd's with me. Like I can physically feel that staff in my side and pulls me back into the fold. I can imagine David needed this comfort time and time again. That he needed to be reminded that God was with him. Like in the running away, in the hiding, in the fleeing, God was present with him. That he hadn't forgotten him. That he hadn't forgotten the promise and his anointing that he would be the next king. Even though there probably were many days where David and the few people that were with him were kind of like, okay, God, like, is this ever going to end? Like, every day we're just running for our lives. Every day we feel outmanned. Every day we feel outnumbered. Like, it just feels like at any point, 100 people could come and just kill us in an instant. We're always on edge. Like, God, where are you at? And time again, David remembered the Lord's words to him. He remembered God's faithfulness. He remembered how God provided, and that brought him comfort. He knew that God's spirit and God's presence was with him. And I think that's so true for us today as well. As followers of Jesus, when you make that decision to put your faith and trust in Jesus, believing he died on the cross, and he rose again 3 days later, that we have, then God's spirit indwells in us. And his spirit, as it talks about in the New Testament, the Holy Spirit is a comforter to us. He's an encouragement to us. He is a daily reminder that God is with us. And so when we're being led through difficult times, when we're being led through seasons of life where we're really afraid or scared or we don't know what's going to happen, we can trust that God is with us, that there is purpose and meaning as to why we're having to go through what we're going through. And that leads us to our last point here in verses 5 and 6, is that we can trust God not only because he provides, not only because he comforts, but because he redeems. Because God redeems. He brings life out of death. He brings light out of darkness. The things that seem like weren't going to work, God is able to make happen. And he does this time and time again. And David recognizes this truth. Even though he hasn't seen redemption yet, even though he hasn't become king yet, even though he's on the run and he has no idea how many more days, months, years he's going to be on the run fearing for his life, he knows that God will redeem. And so look with me here in verses 5 and 6 as David writes this and declares this. It says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil and my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." What's so powerful about this first part of verse 5 is this idea of having a table in the presence of enemies. And so for David, this was the picture, that he's on the run, he's going all over these places, yet time and time again, David was able to be surrounded by his friends, people who have stuck close to him, even though there are way more enemies who are trying to chase after him and kill him and take his life. And so David is reminding himself, hey, even though I'm in the presence of enemies all around me, I have this table where I can gather and I can be with people who love me and care about me. But those relationships that David had were not just relationships that got him through the season of fleeing. These were some of the closest relationships, spiritual advisors that then were a part of his kingdom years down the road. Some of these became his soldiers, his mighty men, his top commanders. They were there with him in the darkest valleys. And when God allowed David to become king, those relationships had another purpose. There was redemption. Before it was just, hey, we're holding on to this together. And now it's, hey, now we're leading God's people together. And so David was reminded of that truth. And maybe over these last couple of years, you've forged relationships with people that maybe you hadn't forged before. People that you grew close to in the midst of everything that we've gone through. Believe that God not only blessed you with those people right now, but that God wants to continue to grow those relationships. That he wants to continue to use those people and to use you to do the same for them, to encourage them, to be encouraged by them, to inspire them, to be inspired by them, so that we together, as we talk about, it's on the side of our building, that together we would help more and more people find new life in Jesus Christ. But not only that, we see that here in verse 6, he says, "Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life." In the midst of that difficulty, darkness, he's saying, hey, your love, your goodness is right here with me, but it's also, end of verse 6, "I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The redemption that David is looking forward to, yes, is when he's no longer on the run and can become king, but he knows the only thing that's really going to satisfy, the only thing that's really going to redeem everything that he's gone through, is knowing that he gets to spend his eternity with his Savior and his Father. That's the thing that's going to make it worth it. And sometimes this is a hard reality to swallow. And I understand that, and I get that. because myself included, we want to experience redemption in the here and now. We want to see God bring us through whatever it is. We want to be able to get through this fear or season of just uncertainty, and we're like, we're scared, and we don't know what's going to happen, and we want to see God work. We want to come on the other side of that, and I believe God does. He does that for David. He does that for Job. He does that for so many other people. What that always looks like in our mind, though, right now, where we're in the midst of that darkest valley, it may look different than what God has planned. But we know that the shepherd provides. We know the shepherd's plan for our life is better than anything we as sheep could think of. And many times, God aligns those plans with our hearts, and he gives those desires in us. And with David, he was confident. He said, "You anoint my head with oil." Like, you've reminded me physically, but also a picture spiritually, that I will no longer be on the run, that I will become king someday. Like, it will happen. And so we hold on to this. He's looking for redemption. And God does redeem. But ultimately, what God desires to do is to redeem for eternity. That we would be reminded when we are afraid, when we're scared, that death, discouragement, disease, whatever it is, that there's one day when we pass from this world and we get to see Jesus face to face, we will be ultimately redeemed. We'll have that perfect relationship with him again. And that perspective puts in perspective what we're going through right now, the fears and the uncertainties and the unknowns that we face. And David was confident of that truth, and I believe you and I can be confident of that truth today. And so I want to share a story real quick from our missionary of the month, our June mission partner, William and Alexandra Decina. William, a couple years ago, recorded his testimony. And it will be in Spanish. You'll see the English subtitles on the bottom that you can read. And William, he's got a story of redemption, of things that were going on in his life that were crazy, and just you never thought you had to go through it. He lived in just this fear and uncertainty, and how God has redeemed, and God is using him in mighty ways right now on this earth, as well as having an eternal impact. So go ahead, turn your attention to the screen and hear our story from William.
Mi nombre es William Decena Pérez, nacido en Batey 5, en República Dominicana. Me crié en un hogar donde a mí me enseñaban cómo practicar el vudú. Era totalmente una vida muy desagradable a Dios, muy desenfrenado. En esa trayectoria nosotros teníamos que trabajar para almacenar dinero por un año. Y ese año teníamos que comprar arroz, habichuela, cerdo, todos esos alimentos que almacenábamos durante un año. Entonces teníamos que hacer un hoyo y enterrar esa comida para rendirle homenaje a Satanás. No podíamos comer, toda la comida estaba en la casa, no podíamos tocar nada. Viendo toda esa situación, cómo vivíamos, una familia arrastrada, una familia pobre, tenía mucha depresión, pero dentro de todas esas cosas parece como que Dios tenía un plan conmigo. Y en el año 1974, un pastor llega a mi casa y me habló de Cristo. Él me hablaba que la sangre de Cristo podía liberarme. Entonces yo le decía, yo no necesito la sangre de Cristo, porque yo tengo una sangre en mi casa que me dieron mis abuelos, que también me protege. Y el pastor siguió insistiendo hasta llegar un día, en el año 1974, ya finalizando el año, tomé la decisión, acepté a Cristo como mi salvador personal. El pastor vio como un potencial en mi liderazgo. Entonces, él me empoderó, me estuvo dando seguimiento, ayudándome. Y empecé con los jóvenes a trabajar en la iglesia en el año 1980. Entonces, fui instalado pastor de la iglesia allá en Batey 5, donde yo me convertí. Comencé a preparar a otros jóvenes y duré 7 años pastoreando en la iglesia de Batey 5. En el año 1987 vine con un pastor aquí, Batey 9. Todavía aún no había pastores, pero ellos se reunían en una casita y oraban. Cuando yo llegué, todo era un proceso difícil. Logramos conseguir las series, los contenedores que no había, el acueducto, la escuela que hay en la comunidad, conseguimos vivienda para la familia. Eso ha sido un gran impacto. Dios empezó a bendecir a la comunidad. Le doy gracias a Dios porque alguien vio ese potencial en mí. Y estudiando la Biblia, he aprendido también que debía ser un multiplicador. Y eso me ayudó a ver potencial en otras personas que hoy también están pastoreando. Soy el pastor William De Sena, de la comunidad de Batey 9, Barahona. Pertenezco a Go Ministry y también pertenezco a un equipo de pastores y líderes trabajando para plantar 1,000 iglesias en 10 años.
Yeah, absolutely. Just what a powerful testimony, and so grateful that many of you over the years have been able to go down to the Batey 9 and visit William and Alexandra and be a part of their ministry and support them and encourage them. And I mean, just what a story. Living a life, you know, full of fear and a part of the voodoo, really more cultural thing than it is a religious thing in the Dominican, and having to come through that and figure out that that's not real and don't have to be bound by that and can find freedom in Christ, and having to leave then some of the things that maybe he was tied to with his family in order to step into what God was calling him into. And now the work that God is doing in him is just amazing. That he's going around, knowing that he's going into homes and he's meeting with people who are bound by the things that he had to deal with a long time ago. And there can be fear and being scared a little bit of what's going to happen. I'm going to go into this house. They're not going to be happy. What's going to happen? Is it going to be a story like mine? Is it going to be a story like something else? And yet God continues to use him. He's redeeming what has happened in the past for his good. And now William is helping plant more churches and train up more pastors and leaders in the Dominican. And so as we move into this time of reflection and communion, where we remember what Jesus did for us on the cross, there's communion cups there in the seat backs in front of you. You can grab them. In a moment, we'll take those together as Kathy Bennett leads us in taking a focus. But there's a few questions that are based on these words that we talked about. Throw them up on the screen real quick. Is that when you're afraid, ask yourself this. Who are you trusting in? Are you trusting in your own provision or God's? Are you trusting in own ways to find comfort in this life or God's? Are you trusting in your own plan of redemption or God's? My hope and my prayer is that just this morning, one of those words, one of those questions would really speak to your heart. And that you would offer that up to God and say, God, I'm afraid of whatever it is, but I trust you because I know that you provide better than I could ever provide. You bring comfort better than I could ever find comfort. Or that, God, I know that you redeem. You have a better plan than I could ever, ever, ever imagine. And so as we remind ourselves and the worship team sings over us, let's take this time to reflect and think about this. And after that, Kathy Bennett is going to come up and lead us in communion. I do want to just make this disclaimer. Kathy's going to be sharing a story about an experience she had in the DR over 10 years ago. And it's a fear-filled experience for her. It's one of the first times she's sharing this publicly. And I'm really proud of her that she really felt called by the Spirit to share this story. And even after the service, if you want to touch base with Kathy and ask her more about it, she would love to talk about how God's redemption has worked in this story and what she went through when she was there at the DR with a team here from our church. So let's take some time now. Let's reflect. Let's ask God to speak to us today.